Let's get started. Again, reminder, the project one will be due next Monday at midnight. And then we'll talk about project two on Monday as well. And then we will assign people to groups. I'll do this later today. So it's your last chance to sign up on your own. Otherwise, I'll just randomly pick a group for you to be in. So for today's class, I sort of emphasized this on Monday, that we're going to be talking about OLTP indexes that are being relevant for what you're going to need to do for project number two. So for today, we're going to spend time in the beginning talking about how do you actually implement a latch. Because I'm assuming most of you here may have taken an OS course or a systems course. And when we talk about latches, you may not know exactly what the implementation details of that. You may be just mostly familiar with using mutexes. And so there's more complicated and sophisticated approaches to using latches that we'll talk about here. And then we'll switch into now talking about the modern OLTP indexes. So the paper you guys read was from Microsoft Research on the BW tree. So even though we'll start in the beginning talking about latches, then we're going to talk about a BW tree, which is an index that doesn't even need to use latches at all. And then from there, we'll talk about how to do concurrent skip lists. And I'll spend a little bit of time at the end talking about the RADEX tree from Hyper, which is not a latch-free index as far as I know. One of the core things you have to understand we're going to do latches, and actually a lot of the techniques of how we're going to use in the BW tree to be latch-free, is the ability to do the atomic compare and swap operation. So this is an instruction that modern CPUs have that allow you to read a value in memory and then compare it to some other value, and if it matches, then you can overwrite it with a new value. And so this is sometimes called CPU intrinsics because it's an intrinsic functionality of the processor that a compiler will expose to you, right? So in the case of Linux, in libc, they have a CPU intrinsic called sync, bool, compare, and swap, and there's other variations of this. Although it looks like a function, what's actually going to happen is that the compiler is going to convert this into the single CPU instruction to perform this operation. So instead of writing, you could write your own assembly block in C or C++ to make a call to the exact instruction to do the compare and swap. But compilers will provide you with what looks like a function, but gets rewritten to be the assembly that you need. Right? So this is actually much faster than doing this you can sort of think of this like an inline function call that's going to be emitting assembly rather than other arbitrary C code. So in this case here, for our function, the first thing we'll see in our argument, we're going to have an address. So that's going to be some location in memory that's going to have some typed value. And we're going to look at it. And then in the second argument, then this is the value that we're going to expect to be there in our memory location. And then if it is there, then this is the new value that we want to write into it. So in this example here, when we make this call to the intrinsic, we'll say we at this memory location, we expect the value to be 20, and if it is, then we want to overwrite it to 30. And we're allowed to do this, and it'll get overwritten over here. And again, we're doing this as a single instruction, right? We don't have to set a lock like a mutex and then have an if clause to check things and then do our swap. We're doing this with sort of one invocation in hardware, which is really, really fast. So likewise, now if we want to do compare value 25 and new value 35, that obviously doesn't work because the value is different. So in this case here, for the sync bool intrinsic, it will return false. There's other variations where you can get back the current value and things like that. So we're going to use these compare and swap instructions as a building block to allow us to do more sophisticated latching inside the database system. So in general, there's basically four approaches of how we can do latching. There's maybe a few more that are out there that I don't know about, but these are the major ones that are actually implemented in database systems today. So we're going to go through each of these one by one, and we'll see how we can use the compare and swap instruction to perform latching. So the probably one that everyone's familiar with, like if you take an OS course, you're going to know about mutexes. Basically, it's an operating system provided mutex to perform these synchronized regions. So they're really easy to use, and this is what, again, everyone is taught when you start doing any kind of systems programming. So pthread mutex is the sort of the standard one in Linux that you can use. Essentially what happens is you declare that you have a mutex lock, and then down below you can lock it and then do something special in your critical region and unlock it when you're done. So again, this is really easy to use. This is what everyone does when the first time they write a concurrent program. But mutexes are terribly slow. So if you have no contention, then doing the lock and unlock is really fast because it's essentially just doing a compare and swap underneath the covers. But if someone holds the lock when you try to acquire it, it's going to be at least 25 to 30 nanoseconds to go make that invocation. Because what happens is when you call mutex lock and someone else holds the lock, that it ends up being a futex syscall down in the kernel. So now your kernel's taking locks too. And then now underneath the covers, the operating system is going to maintain these internal queues about all the threads that are waiting to acquire locks. And it provides these hints to its scheduler to make decisions about what thread to run next. Right, so if your thread tries to acquire this mutex lock and it's blocked, it's denied, then the operating system wants to know that you're not going to do any useful work, so therefore the scheduler is not going to schedule you. So this is why you have to go down in the kernel when you take a mutex lock. Right? If no one holds the lock, then it's just a compare and swap, and that's fast. Right? Futex stands for, I think, fast user space locks. But as soon as there's contention, it's going to at least be 25 to 30 nanoseconds to do the lock and unlock call. So it's 25 nanoseconds. Is that a lot? He's shaking his head no. How much is a call to memory to read something from memory? What's that? 90 to 100 nanoseconds, right? So this is kind of expensive, right? If you're doing this over and over and over again. So this is bad. So this is why like people in the 90s basically wrote their own mutexes, but now every single modern database systems that's doing any kind of locking doesn't use mutexes at all. I think in our code, we have some nasty mutexes that are sitting around, and we did that because it was easy to do, right? I'm not proud of it. We'll eventually get rid of it. But in general, you don't want to use mutexes. What people normally use instead are what are called spin locks or test and set spin locks. And the basic idea of this is that we're going to do compare and swap, but instead of using an operating system primitive to do our locking, we're going to maintain our lockings in our user space, in our application. So the database system is going to manage this. So the basic idea is that we'll do a compare and swap on a memory location, and if we don't get it, we'll just spin in a while loop and try to come back and do it again. Right? So it essentially looks like this. So you can use in the standard template library for C++, there's an atomic flag type, and this is essentially just a Boolean or a single bit. And then it provides sort of a nice abstraction over top of the CPU intrinsics to do compare and swap. So this makes it a little bit more portable. So in this case, our thread wants to acquire the lock. It does a test and set. That's the same thing as compare and swap. If we get it, we're done. We pop out of the while loop. If not, we loop back around and try to get it again. And the reason why this is a bit more complicated than like a mutex that the operating system provides is because it's up to us to decide what we want to do in this inner loop. Right? We could try to yield the thread back to the OS scheduler. We could abort because we tried too many times. We could sleep a little bit and try to back off, or we can just come back right again and try to get it. Right? So this is going to be much more efficient because we're not going into the kernel and making any syscalls. But now we have to add some extra stuff in our operating system, or sorry, in our database system, to make sure that we don't have starvations and priority issues and other things like that. So it's more work on the database side, but in general, that's usually the conventional wisdom in a database system. We always want to do as much as possible as we can and don't rely on the operating system to do anything. And this is why we don't use mmap or memory map files. We manage our own memory. Another key problem, other than just the complexity of how you manage this inner part here, is it's not a cache-friendly approach. Right? So let's say we have a single lock, and we have three CPU cores, three threads running on separate cores trying to access that lock. So they keep spinning, calling compare and swap over and over again. And what happens? Why is this not cache-friendly? The lock is somewhere else, right? It could be at another core. And then every single time these guys are making an invocation to try to acquire it, we have to send an invalidation message or a fetch message to go grab that memory location, bring it to our local L1, L2 cache for our core, and then try to do the compare and swap. And chances are we're going to fail, right? If we have a highly, if there's a lot of contention in the system, they're just keep spinning over and over again, and there's all this network traffic on the chip itself as we move this memory location around, right? So this is bad. So the alternative or a better approach to doing test and set spin locks is to do called queue-based spin locks. And sometimes you'll see these called MCS spin locks. I always forget what that, it doesn't actually, you know, it's actually named after the people that invented it. I never remember their names. So it's Mellor, Crummy, and Scott. That's two guys. And so the basic idea is we're going to use the same spin lock approach that we have in the test and set example, but instead of having a single lock that everyone's going to try to acquire, we're going to have a queue of locks. And it'll sort of be like a convoy. And so only one CPU thread will try to acquire a single lock, and then we'll build out the queue behind it, and all subsequent threads that come along try to acquire the locks that come behind, you know, come later on. And so you can still implement this with using the atomic flag, because it's the same thing as the spin lock as we had before. The basic idea is we're going to have sort of a base lock or a base latch. And instead of having a single bit, we could have, actually, atomic flag, you want to use atomic pointer, but whatever. For next, the next is going to be a pointer to another lock in a chain of these things or a queue of these things. So when the first guy comes along and he goes to acquire a lock, nobody has it, so he's allowed to acquire it, and he's going to do a compare and swap on this next pointer. And what he's going to install is another same struct of the same kind of queue lock here that has its own next pointer, that which is now null. So when the next CPU comes along and he goes to the base lock and tries to acquire it, it's going to see that he can't because it's not null. So he's going to then follow the chain here and try to do a compare and swap on this lock. And since he's the first one there, he'll be allowed to acquire it. Now he's waiting for this guy to finish up before he is granted access to the latch, but he's not spinning over on this thing here. He is spinning on this. Subsequent people will spin on his, right? So the next guy comes along, he would follow this chain, he would spin, I guess the error should be over here, he will be spinning on this one. So now we don't have that same problem where we have a single memory location that everybody's trying to do a compare and swap. This memory location that they're spinning on will be local to it, right? So it can sit in L1, L2, very close to where this thing's spinning, and then eventually when this guy releases, it releases the next latch, and he's granted access. Right, and then everyone just, again, you don't have to worry about cache coherence traffic or cache invalidation messages because everybody's just going at their rec location. Right, so this is actually what they use in Linux, and a lot of database systems are using this approach here, at least the more modern ones, if you have to take a latch. The problem is, though, this gets more complicated because, like, let's say you can have a thread decide that it doesn't want to wait anymore, like it times out. So therefore, you want to release it. You know, you don't want to spin on the lock anymore. You have to release it, and therefore, you have to do compare and swap to sort of fill in the gap and delete it in the linked list. So it gets more complicated to do this than just the single bit that you spin through, right? But you get the advantage of it. It helps if you have a lot of cores, and then you're not ping-ponging messages back and forth. So the last approach is called reader-writer locks. And this is basically the same thing you think of in a database system when you have sort of shared and exclusive locks. So rather than having a single bit that everyone's trying to flip, we're gonna have different locks that correspond to readers and writers. So in our single latch, we'll have a read lock and we'll have a write lock. But now we're also gonna maintain a counter for the number of threads that have currently hold each of these locks, and the number of threads that are currently waiting for these locks. And you have separate counters for both types of locks. So when the first guy comes along, right, he wants to read, so he's going to try to acquire the read lock. Nobody else is holding it, so he can do the compare and swap and get it right away. But then we'll update the counter to say that we know that at least one thread is holding this read lock. The next guy comes along, same thing, he wants to acquire the read lock, and since that's commutative with somebody else also holding the same read lock, he'll be granted that lock as well, and then we update the counter. Now, when the right guy comes along, he wants to acquire the right lock, we would see that the read lock is being held, and therefore, we're going to have to stall and wait. And we update a queue that says we know there's a right lock waiting. So now, let's say we have this next thread. He wants to acquire the read lock. What should happen with him? What's that? Sorry. Right, he said, why should he wait?
Oh, because
exactly right. So we would see, we know that somebody is waiting for the right lock, and therefore we should stall and wait ourselves here, right? And eventually these guys will release the latches, and then the right lock can go. And this avoids starvation for anybody who wants to do reads and writes. All right? So again, this is being built on top of the spin locks that we talked about before, but there's a little bit of extra management we're doing in our database system to make sure that threads are treated fairly. And this, you'll see this more common in database systems that support transaction priorities. So a lot of times in the enterprise systems, you can specify that, you know, for these transactions, you know, they're minor background processes, and therefore they shouldn't be given high priority. I don't care if they get preempted by somebody else. But something that's more latency sensitive, like a transaction that's interacting with an actual customer or another machine, you want that to get higher priority. You want that to be able to finish more quickly, right? So in order to implement those policies at a high level, you actually maybe need to consider them in your latching policy as well. So, all right, so that's basically how you do latching. I don't remember what kind of latching primitives we provide you in Peloton, but we will specify everything in for Tuesday's project, or Monday's project announcement. Okay, so given I just talked about, you know, how to do latching, and then last class we talked about how to do index locking at the leaf levels, now we're sort of going to ignore all of that for now, and we're going to talk about how you can do indexing in OLTP scenarios without having to do any latches at all. So the first two guys we'll talk about, the BW tree and the concurrent skip list, these are latch free indexes that are actually used in production today. And this last one is the ART index, which is a RADEX tree. As far as I know, it's not latch free, but it doesn't take that, you know, much thinking to think about how to make it latch free, but we're going to ignore that for now. Okay, so the BW tree came out of the Hackathon project from Microsoft Research. We read the Hackathon paper on MVCC. This is the index that they developed for it. And remember that I said in the early days when the project got started at MSR, they were considering skip lists. And they then later decided that they could come up with a better index structure that could outperform skip lists. And this is what the BW tree was. So I don't have any prizes to give, but does anybody want to take a guess what BW in BW tree stands for? Nobody. You might be disappointed when you find out.
Big wheels?
That's a new one, okay. What's that? Windows? No. In the back. Buzzword, there it is, right? So it's a latch-free index for main memory databases with for many cores and yada yada, right? It's the buzzword tree. I don't know why they couldn't think of a better name, but that's what it is. So this was developed, the paper you guys read was from Justin Lewandowski. So he is actually somebody that has been in prison, but he was in a foreign prison. So that's an example. He's an example of somebody that has played the rough game of databases, and now he's at MSR, and I think they're really doing awesome work there. So the BW tree is essentially a latch-free B plus tree. Now, they talk about being a B link tree. That just means they have maybe some extra pointers. The idea is the same thing we talked about last class. And so the key thing is, because it's latch-free, it means that no threads are ever going to have to stall trying to acquire any locks and latches. Right? When you think of, again, a typical B plus tree, when you have to do a split and merge, you have to lock the node you're splitting or merging plus its parent. Right? In their case, they're not going to have to do any of that. And the way they're going to achieve this is through two key ideas. The first is that all updates to the index itself will never do anything, make any changes in place to the nodes. And instead, they're going to apply deltas or add deltas to those nodes that you can then read at runtime and to figure out what the correct state of the node should be. And this is helping them reduce cache invalidation because, you know, if someone has a copy of a page in their local cache and you have the same copy of the page, when you modify them, you just put new deltas on top of it. You don't actually have to go and invalidate the page that they have a copy of. The second key thing is that they're going to use a mapping table as a way to use indirect pointers or indirect addresses to all the pages in the tree. And this, again, we'll see this in a second, but this is allow them to do compare and swap at single memory locations and not worry about, you know, having dangling pointers to new pages as you add them and remove them. So these are the two key ideas. If you understand how this works, and we'll go through in more detail, this is how they're going to be able to achieve the latch-free guarantee. So our mapping table is essentially going to be a hash table that maps a page ID to a physical address. And then within the actual logical structure itself, we'll maintain these logical pointers between the nodes. And so every page is going to be given an ID, and then from that, you can use the mapping table to know where in memory the page is located. So for these internodes here, right, between for child and siblings, these are just going to be logical addresses that are embedded in the page. So anytime if I'm at this page here and I want to get to 104, I have to go look up in my mapping table to know where in memory that is. Again, this is going to then allow them to move this guy around or resize it, do whatever they want, and not worry about having to update this pointer here, because it's only a single location that they need to modify, and they can do compare and swap on this. Remember how we talked about last class, it's really hard. Part of the reason why MemSQL doesn't do the reversible skip list is because that means you would have to do a compare and swap on two pointers, right, from the child to the parent, from the previous guy to the next guy. And you can't do that if it's atomically without setting a mutex. But you can do a compare and swap if you know this, it's one location you have to modify. So let's look how they do updates. For this, we're going to ignore the rest of the tree. We'll just look at a simple leaf node. Or look at one page at a time. So what's going to happen is every time you want to modify a key in a page, right, do an insert, update, or delete, instead of, again, making the change directly in the data structure in the page itself, you're going to add a delta above it. So in this case here, we'll have a delta record in memory that says we want to insert the key 50. And so this delta record is going to have a physical pointer to the base page that it's modifying. Right? It's not a logical pointer, it's actually a physical pointer. And what happens is we want to do a compare and swap now to now point the page address, instead of being the base page, to now point to our delta record. Right? So in this case here, for page 102, we want to do a compare and swap for its physical address in memory here, which is, again, we can do in the single instruction, and it's really fast. And then now what happens is anytime someone is doing research or traversing the tree, when they want to go look at page 102, they would land here instead of here. And inside of this delta record will be a little bit in the header that says, I'm a delta record, not a regular page. And therefore, the thread would know how to interpret it and figure out what it should be doing. And the reason why we can store the direct memory address here is because we're going to be treating sort of a single page and all its deltas as a single logical unit, single atomic unit. So it's never going to be the case that this thing is going to get swapped out and this thing is going to point to nothing, because we're going to treat the delta chain and its base table all at once as a single unit. And we can do this again. Say we get the next guy, we want to do a delete on 48. Again, we do a compare and swap, and now this guy is now the beginning of the version chain, right? So now to do a search on this, again, we're ignoring traversing the upper levels of the tree, right? We just sort of land at a leaf node and through these logical pointers, and then we would end up here for the first delta chain. So what would happen is we would go through each of these delta records one by one. And if we see that the key that we're looking to access or modify is in our delta chain, then we know we found the thing that we're looking for. And we can ignore anything else that comes down in the delta chain. So for example, if I'm looking for key 50, if I start here, I don't see it, I move here, now I see insert 50, I don't care what comes after below this, because I know that at this point in time, right, this is the newer version of the page, my record 50 is there. So it doesn't matter if there's a delete 50 coming after it. As soon as I find it, I know I'm done. And then if I follow my chain and I get to the page and see that there wasn't a delta record for the key that I want, then I just do the regular binary search within the sort of key array that's inside of the page, just as you would in a regular B plus tree. Right? So the compare and swap thing is very important, because this is going to allow us to have concurrent operations without having to set any heavy latches, right? Anything like a mutex. So let's say that we have two threads try to install updates to our page here, right? And since insert 50 is the current head of the delta chain, both these guys are going to have physical pointers going there. But now we're going to do a compare and swap to our physical address in the mapping table, and only one of them is going to be able to succeed, right? So at like this point in time, say you have two threads, add these both delta records, and at the exact same time, they're going to do a compare and swap to try to overwrite the physical address for 102 to be whatever their physical address is here. And again, because it's an atomic instruction in the CPU, only one of them is going to succeed, right? One's going to get true, one's going to get false. right? So in that case, when the thread that recognizes that it did not succeed in doing this overwrite, it's going to have to delete itself and try again, right? And what policy you use when you fail to update the physical address depends on what kind of operation you're doing. We'll see in a second. When we do consolidation, if we failed because somebody else added something to the delta chain, then maybe we just throw away what we've done and somebody else will try it. But in the case of a operation on keys, like an insert, well, then we would just create a new delta or change our pointer to now point to this one, and then do compare and swap and see whether we get to be the front of the delta chain. Okay? So there are basically three types of delta records we can have in a BW tree. So we've already talked about the record update stuff, right? We already talked, you can do insert, update, and delete. But then there's another one where we can do structural modifications to the tree itself. So we can do splits and merges by, again, just appending deltas to the chain. There's a third one in the paper that talks about how you write the index pages itself out to a flash drive or an SSD, and they use like a log structured merge tree on disk to store these changes. We're going to ignore all of that because you don't, you know, we don't care because everything's in main memory. But in all the stuff that we're talking about still works, even though we're not durable to disk. Remember I said typically what happens in an in-memory database system, you don't write the indexes out to disk because it's a waste of time, right? You assume your node's going to be always running, and you'll use replication and other high availability techniques to have a backup so that if your master node goes down, you have another guy that can pick up right where he left off. And so you don't have to spend the time rebuilding the index, and you don't have to spend the time at runtime because you're assuming that you're not going to fail to write things out to disk and make sure that it's durable. So we can ignore all the log structure stuff in the paper, and everything still works. So let's see how we do consolidation. So the problem with these delta chains is we keep appending things to them as we modify them, and eventually it gets really, really long. So now that makes our search times increase because we're going to keep having to look at these delta chains one by one by one, and maybe eventually we get to the base node. So what we're going to want to do is we're going to want to create a new page that will consolidate all of the deltas and apply them to the base page and have that be the new page or new representation of this page. So let's get this case here. Let's say we'll make a copy of page 102, and then we'll take all the deltas that we have in our chain in order going from top to bottom, actually the other way, from bottom to top, and we'll apply them to our copied page. And then now once that's done, we want to do another compare and swap operation in our mapping table to now point to our new page. And if we're successful, then we know that by the time we applied all these deltas to their new page, nobody else added any other new one. So we know that everything's consistent. We don't lose any updates when we install this. And then now at this point, if this compare and swap is successful, we can then mark this page to be deleted later on. And they have a garbage collection mechanism that we'll talk about of how you make sure that nobody else is modifying this as you move stuff around. All right, so the way they're going to do garbage collection is they're going to organize the operations into these quantums called epochs. And the basic idea is that anytime you want to do an operation in the index, you join an epoch and say that I'm a thread that's operating in the index at this time. And what happens is anytime you determine that there is an object in the tree that can be deleted, you add it to the epoch's sort of listing of objects that can be deleted. And the idea is that when all the threads in the epoch are no longer running in there, then you know anything that was marked for deletion can be safely deleted because nobody's sitting around and could possibly try to access it. All right? So it looks like this. So this is our example we had before where we created the new consolidated page. And we have, at the same time, while we're applying all our updates, we have somebody traversing, one thread traversing the index of this chain on CPU1. So they'll add themselves to the epoch table. Say, I'm a thread running. Here's what I'm doing. And then we have another thread here that's actually doing the consolidation part. So he would add themselves to the epoch table as well. So now we do a compare and swap, and this guy's now the new page. And therefore, we know that everything that is in this node, including all its deltas, can be reclaimed as soon as all the threads that are accessing it are done. Because again, what you don't want to happen is if this guy immediately just deleted it right away, then this thread would be trying to then traverse this physical pointer and end up with garbage, end up with nowhere. right? So it's a barrier to make sure that you know, nobody's sort of hanging around with dangling pointers. So CPU 2 finishes, and then he gets removed from the epoch table. Eventually, CPU 1 gets finished, and he's moved from the epoch table. And now we know that no other thread could be in our index anywhere. So now it's safe for us to reclaim the space. Right, we delete all the delta chains, maybe put it back in a memory pool, and then can reuse it later on. Right, it's pretty simple, pretty easy to do. And you can do all of this in latch-free data structures directly inside of the epoch as well. Right, you could use a concurrent skip list to keep track of the list of threads that are running. Okay, so the thing that I find, sorry, yes.
So when you replace this page with the new page,
yes.
You're avoiding cache allocation,
right?
But then you now incur like,
the
overhead time to access all the entries
in
that new page,
right? Correct, yeah. So his question is, say all the CPUs have page 102 in their cache. We're not making modifications to it. We're over here, and then eventually this guy gets blown away, and now every CPU thread has to get the copy of new page 102. Yes, it's true, but like you can't avoid that, right? The difference is that for all these other things in the delta chain, I didn't have to invalidate it, right? And maybe I go read a small delta record and bring that in my local CPU cache, but it's, you know, that's much smaller than just taking, you know, the whole 4K thing and having it, you know, invalidate that everywhere. The question is, if you have, say it again, I missed it.
So if there was a bunch of entries in there that you didn't modify,
yes.
When you swap the pointer, kind of like invalidating them because they're no longer in that cache, right? Because it's a new page.
Correct.
So you have to incur the bandwidth of all those new entries that were not written to. That wouldn't have been invalidated.
Right. So obviously there's a trade-off, like how long do you let the delta chain go before you consolidate and things like that. Right, because in that case, if the delta chain gets too long, then you spend all the time traversing it for every single operation. If you think about like a traditional B plus tree, what it's going to do. So anytime you modify something, you have to keep the array sorted inside of it. So that's definitely going to be moving more bits around than this other thing. It's a good point, though. Like, yeah, there's like, I don't want to claim that cache invalidation goes away entirely. It's just significantly reduced than what you would have in a B plus tree. I don't understand that point. So his point is that, yes, when this guy gets consolidated and everyone now has to look at this, this page will get thrown out of their CPU caches and they have to go grab the new one. But what I'm saying is that, you have to do that, but that's going to be fewer number of cache reads or number of memory reads to do this rather than every single time you have a new update, you have to modify the sorted array that would be inside of the base node or the base page, and all of those would be cast invalidations over and over again. Whereas this is just updating a single pointer in a linked list that is a minor thing, and everyone goes and fetches the one thing that they need, and then anytime they read this delta record, that's probably going to be in their CPU cache as well. So I don't have graphs on this, but the they measure the number of cache invalidations, and it's significantly less. Yes?
What if you're doing like tons of operations on those pages, so inserts and deletes, and if the consolidation phase is long-lived, then there's quite a large probability that the compare and swap would fail.
Yes. Right. So his question is, say this is a hot page, right? This is Justin Bieber on Twitter or whatever Drake, whatever the hot person now is, and everyone's trying to do like, and therefore there's all these like delta chains building behind it, and then I try to do a consolidation. And if it takes a long time, then the likelihood that someone's going to come and invalidate me, I won't be able to do the compare and swap because they get pointed up to a new delta record, right? And therefore, I did all this work and have to waste it, right? So there's a trade-off. Right? There's no free lunch. I don't know what they do, but you can imagine like.
Happened after you and point to the new page.
His comment is, so let's say, let me go back.
I think what they do in the paper is they just have all, because there's just a threshold, so all the threads will do the same thing before they try to insert something.
Yeah, so basically, yeah, he's right, yeah. So I'll get to that. So his comment was, let's say that I'm doing the consolidation, but I'm at when there was only delete 48. So I do the consolidation, and then when I try to do a compare and swap, I fail because insert 55 got put in. So couldn't I just recognize that insert 55 came after I started doing my consolidation and just apply that and try to do compare and swap again?
I'll do a compare and swap on the pointer of insert 55 instead.
Yeah, correct. So the pointer's here. When we started doing consolidation, it was at 48. So we have 48, 50, and page 102 in here. Now we do compare and swap. We see that it's pointing to 55, so that's a new delta record that we missed. So you could start at that and go back up and apply more of those changes and then try to do a compare and swap again. You could do that. I think that might work. He's right. In the paper, what they do is you recognize how long the chain is, and then if it's above some threshold, then any thread that comes along tries to start reading the chain will try to do the consolidation. So you could have all 20 cores, 20 threads, all trying to do the consolidation at the same time. One of them will succeed, and everyone else just backs off and throws their work away. But again, the key thing is you don't need a mutex to make this work. But I think your approach actually might work as well. But
every thread has to stop.
Correct. Yes. So you could have a little blip at some point in time where everyone tries to do this. Yes. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Compare and swap is a really powerful construct that allows us to make this all work. So let's spend more time now talking about the structure modifications, because this is the key thing. This is one of the key advantages that the BW tree gives over a B+ tree. So the first thing to point out is that all the page sizes are elastic. So if something gets too big, when we do the consolidation, if your keys are too big and they're not going to fit in the page, when we do consolidation, we just can allocate more memory for things, right? So that's not a big deal. So this allows us to be more flexible when we decide to actually do splitting. So the BW tree is going to support doing the sort of the standard half split. So I have, four keys. I want to split two per page. And you can do this without doing any latching. It's really easy. So the basic idea of what's going to happen is we're going to add these new delta records above the page we're splitting to say that a split has occurred. And then we add new separator delta records at the higher levels of the tree to provide guidance to anybody that's searching the tree of where the split has occurred, and so they can shortcut the split record and jump right to the page that they're looking for. So I spent a lot of time yesterday trying to make this this diagram make sense. So I apologize. There's just going to be a lot of lines, and it's sort of complicated with these arrows. But I'll try to go through step by step and point out what's going on here to show an example of how to do a split. So for this, for simplicity reasons, I'm only showing one direction of the B+ tree and the leaves from sibling to sibling. There's obviously pointers in the other direction, but nothing really fundamentally changes to make this work because we're using logical pointers and that hides all the complexity of things. All right, so we have a two-level BW tree, we have a root node, and then we have three children nodes, three leaf nodes. And so the first thing we're gonna do is lay out our keys across all these nodes. So page 102 will have keys 1 and 2, page 103 will have 3, 4, 5, and 6, and page 104 will have 7 and 8. So what we're going to want to do is we're going to split this middle guy here and put half its keys on a new page and keep the other half keys there. So we'll keep 3 and 4 here, and we'll put 5 and 6 on a new page. So the first thing we have to do is just allocate a new page, right? And we can have since we know it's going to go in between here, we can set its next sibling to be a logical pointer to 104. And then now we just update our page table to now, or mapping table to now point to our new guy. So then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to add a split record above page 103 to tell anybody that comes along later that the split has occurred. So the split's going to have two pointers. We're going to end up invalidating these two keys here. So the first we're going to have a physical pointer that points to the base page for what we're splitting, right? For ignoring that there could be other delta records, but basically the idea is the same thing. You just would append it to the front of the chain. And then we're also going to have a logical pointer that says for keys 5 and 6, you want to go to this page to get it. Okay? So now what we need to do is go and update the physical pointer to page 103 to be, instead of the base page, to now be the split page. And that's just done, just like a parent swap like before. And what this does automatically as well is now this actually modifies the logical pointers in our index to now point to this as well. So before, our root node had these separators that said for key 3, 4, 5, and 6, you want to go to this page, and this guy knew that its sibling was located here. So now by doing the compare and swap on the physical address, we end up automatically updating the logical pointers. And that is, again, we don't have to do any compare and swap for that. That's just done by the nature of modifying the mapping table. So now anybody that traverses the tree would come along and see the split message and say, if I'm looking for key 5, I know I want to go down here and not here, right? 5 and 6 are still stored in our page table because we're not doing in-place updates. It's just that nobody will find them. If you do a traversal along the leaf nodes, right, going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you would follow the logical pointer and end up at the split here as well, right? So no one's going to be able to read these keys at this point. So now the next thing we're going to do is install a separator delta record at the top. And this is going to be updating the ranges that are specified by this root node, right? So here we have a pointer that says negative infinity to 3 should go this way. 3 to 7 should now be pointing at our split, and 7 to infinity should point to this pointer here. And so what this basically is going to do, the separator delta record, is a shortcut to say that if you want keys 5 to 7 exclusive, you want to go to this location down here, right? We don't need this for correctness because, again, if anybody follows this and they say, I'm looking for key 5, they would still look through this range, but then they would hit the split and follow down to our new node, our new page. Right, this is just to make search go faster. And of course, now we have to do the compare and swap on the physical pointer to page 101 to now point to our new separator. So is that clear how that works, right? Again, all this indirection through the mapping table makes everything end up being consistent and correct, and we don't have any dangling pointers. And it's, again, really fast to do using compare and swap. All right, so these are some performance numbers in the paper. They didn't actually include the skip list numbers for two of the workloads, and I emailed Justin last night, and he sent me the full results. I don't know why they excluded the dedupe and Xbox workloads in the paper. But here we're comparing the BW tree versus a B plus tree and then a concurrent skip list. And the B plus tree was based on BerkeleyDB. So BerkeleyDB was one of the first embedded storage manager databases from the 1990s. So this is a sort of, it's doing concurrency, but it's not, I don't think it's writing anything out the disk. Everything's in memory. And then they implemented their own version of a skip list to do this. And so what you see for the first workload is based on this Xbox Live, this workload trace of a bunch of gets and sets. And I think this is primarily gets then sets. It's like it's 7 to 1. The BW tree has been doing 10 million updates a second, 10 million operations a second, whereas the B plus tree is about 560,000, and the skip list is 423. For the synthetic workload and deduplication workload, the magnitude of performance is much lower, and I think this is because there's more writes going on. But still, you see that the BW tree is outperforming these two other indexes, right? So this is part of the reason, again, why the Hexton guys gave up on doing skip lists, because they came up with something that was much better. And as far as I know, no other database system actually implements this. I don't know whether it's because of patent reasons. The BW tree is not open source, but they've been talking about how they want to make it open source, which I think would be kind of cool. So any questions about BW trees? Again, this would be one of the index structures that you can choose to implement for project number 2. Okay, so now let's talk about skip lists again. So again, last class we sort of were kind of hand-wavy about the concurrency side of things, but now we want to look at sort of specific examples of how you do lat tree or skip lists. And the key idea is that we're going to do everything sort of lazily, right? So when we do deletions, it's safe for us to go, you know, keep things around and not worry about corrupting the structure of the index, because we'll be able to mark that items are deleted. And they end up just being sort of any keys that are still in the data structure end up being just sort of guideposts, like you have in a B plus tree, when you keep the keys in the upper levels to help you know which direction to go. So the first operation we're going to look at has to do an insert. So this is the same example we had last class. We want to do insert on key 5. So we know we want to put it in this slot here. So the first thing we're going to want to do is just create all the entries for this new key for all the levels that it should be in. Remember, we're going to flip a coin, and the number of times we flip that coin until we get tails corresponds to how many levels we're going to include it. Let's assume that in this case here, we got 3 heads, so therefore we'll put it in 3 levels. So notice here, we're going to create the keys in our skip list, but we're still maintaining the pointers around it to the entries that come up before. Right? So key 4 doesn't know about key 5 yet, so it's not pointing to it, and it still points to key 6. So now we're going to go from the bottom up and add our entries one by one. And for this, we can just do the compare and swap that we were doing for the mapping table of the BW tree to update this pointer to now point to our new element. And because we're going from the bottom up, it doesn't matter that these upper levels don't know about key 5 yet, right? If someone comes by and they look, say, do I have key 5, they would end up with the end marker here, and that's okay because we're not doing this in the context of a transaction, right? Those are all sort of the phantom avoidance and things like that were all things that the index locking we talked about last time would help you prevent. For this, we just care about, you know, is the structure of the index correct? So then we go up to the next guy, we'll add his key, again, do a compare and swap. And then the next guy, we do a compare and swap as before. So now at this point, our key is fully integrated in the index. We didn't have to take any mutexes. We didn't have to take any heavyweight locks. We can do this with simple compare and swaps. And we don't need the indirection table of that we had in the BW tree. So now let's look at how you do deletes. So let's say we want to delete key 5. So to make this work, we're going to add a new flag to every leaf node or in the bottom layer of the skip list that says whether the element has been deleted or not. And we can use the atomic boolean we saw before, right, a simple bit, and we can do compare and swap on this. So now let's say we get here, we want to delete key 5. We would do a traversal to find key 5, and then we would flip the bit here and say that this thing is deleted. Now what would happen is if anybody comes along, does it scan along the bottom layer, if they would check to see whether it's deleted or not, and if so, they just ignore it and sort of keep on going. Right, so it doesn't matter that we still point to it. We know that nobody else is going to read it. So now what we need to do is go and update all the pointers to now go around it so that nobody actually can find it. I don't think there's an issue if you go from bottom up from top down. All the literature I've been seeing says you want to go top down. I haven't really thought through whether everything's self-safe if you do that. But basically, you're going to go each one, do a compare and swap to reroute it all the way down, and then eventually, once you know that nothing else is pointing to it, you still have to do maybe some bookkeeping to keep track of, make sure that there's no thread that's sitting on this key before you start throwing things away. You can use the same epoch mechanism that the BW tree does. But once we know that we're safe, we can then just delete everything, and then now we're back to where we were before we inserted it. Yes?
For example, there's no key that's inserted between 5 and 6 while you're doing all these operations.
The question is, how can you guarantee that there's no key inserted in 5 and 6 before you delete it? So say you're here, right? Is it before you mark this as deleted or no? Yeah. So the question is, like, say if I have key 4.5, and I'm at this point here. So I would do a seek, and I would find 4. And I would know that the thing that comes after it is 5, therefore this is where I want to go. So I would do a compare and swap on it, and either I would succeed because I was able to change this before this guy did, or I would fail because this guy finished the compare and swap and pointed to 6. If I failed, I would maybe just try it again, right? But you probably have to do some extra check to maybe sort of like, you know, it didn't end up pointing to key 4.25, and therefore I need to come after that. Right, it's a little extra bookkeeping, but the compare and swap, there's nothing, you don't have to set up mutex to do anything. And again, this works because we're not pointing the other direction. Because if you had to point to the other direction, to do this update here, you would also need to be able to update this thing to point back to it and not this guy. Is this clear? Okay. So now, last class, I tried to describe to you how you do reverse search if you don't have the pointers in the other direction. And I thought I was trying to describe what MemSQL does. They had this blog post, and someone posted on Piazza said, the blog post is not clear, and then my explanation was not clear. I actually also emailed the VP engineering at MemSQL and tried to get clarification of what the hell the blog post is actually trying to say, because I thought I understood it, but I guess I didn't. And he said he was in India, so he can't send me details right now because the internet's bad, whatever. But what I did find was another algorithm to do reverse search on a single direction skip list. And it's sort of basically whoever posted on Piazza saying, well, what if you can use the stack? That's one way to do it. Now, the MemSQL guy says, I asked him about this, is that they don't use a stack at all. But what I'm describing to you now is basically more or less what they're doing. They maybe spend some more work doing additional searches. So the way it's going to work is, say here, we want to get the key range K4 to K2 inclusive, but we want to get in reverse order from what the skip list is sorted by. So what we're going to do is we're going to start in the beginning, and we're going to do a seek just as you would looking for the key. But instead of looking for the first key in the range, we want to find the lower bound, right, the lowest value. So we're looking for K2 here. So we start off with this first guy, and it's K2 less than 5, so we skip that. Now we see K2 equals K2, so we know we want to jump to this. And now what we're going to do is, since we know we're at the starting point in the range that we're looking for, we want to maintain a stack. Right, so we look here and say K2 is less than K4, so we don't want to go the direction we want to go down. So now we're at a leaf node, and we want to keep track in a stack of all the nodes that we're going to visit up until we get the upper bound of our range. And then we can go in reverse order and examine those leaf nodes one by one, and that will give us the reverse order that we're looking for in our search. So in this case here, we see K2, then come here, we see K3, we add it to our stack, then we see K4, and now we know we're done because that's the upper bound. So now what we'll do is take our stack and go in the reverse order and look at these one by one, and that gets us what we wanted. Right? So it's a little extra memory to maintain the stack instead of these global pointers to know how to jump forward in the case of the MemSQL route. But I think this is good enough. They claim they can do better with paying a little extra CPU cost, but I don't know exactly what they're doing. So is this clear? The stack makes it much easier, I agree. Okay. So a few minutes left. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time now talking about the adaptive radix tree from the hyper guys. So the radix tree is not latch free, as far as I know. What it's designed to be is a index that is uses less memory, but without paying that huge pointer chasing penalty that the T-tree did that we saw last time. So the way a radix tree, and radix trees are a special case of a try, we'll look at a try in a second. The basic idea is that instead of storing whole keys throughout the index, we're going to store prefixes of it in the tree structure itself. And so those the prefixes are we're going to use to figure out where the record is that we're looking for. And we can do quick comparisons by just sort of going in order of the key we're looking for and looking at sort of one digit at a time. And I say digit not like as a number, but sort of it's like a one position in the key that we're looking at. Whether it's a string, whether it's a date, or whatever. We're going to look at that one by one. So radix trees are kind of interesting because they have properties that are slightly different than what we'd expect in a B+ tree. So the first is that the height of the tree depends on not on the number of elements like it would in a B+ tree, but it depends on the length of the keys itself. So if I have a key with a million, you know, a single key with a million elements, the height of my tree is going to be 1 million. I'm assuming I'm using a try, not a compressed radix tree. It's also not going to require significant rebalancing, right? You can do things like coalesce nodes and collapse them to reduce the height of the tree in the radix case, but you don't need to do any splits and merges and have to take latches to do those things as you would in a B+ tree. And the last thing that's interesting is that the key itself can be reconstructed from the edges of the tree, right? So there's for a single key, it's not going to be stored in its entirety anywhere in the tree. It's going to be along these edges, and if we ever want to get it back, we just append these edges back together. So let me show you an example. So this is an example of a try, and this is an example of a radix tree. So let's say that we have three keys, hello, hat, and have. So in a try, the way that it works is you don't store the the digits of the key in the actual nodes themselves, or in practice you do, you represent them as the edges. So we have a root of our tree, and in the first edge, we're going to have the character H. And that's because all the words, all the keys that we have in our tree start with the letter H. So that this letter can be reused across all the keys. And then going down, we see that the path going to the leaf nodes with a pointer to the element that we want, we see that we have all the letters for each of our keys. So we have H-E-L-L-O for hello, and then for here, for have and hat, they both share A in the second position, so therefore it's only one edge, and then they split off corresponding to both of them. A radix tree is a sort of a compressed version of a try, because you don't need to store individual letters in separate edges. If you know that there's a portion of the key that is not shared with any other key, you just store it in entirety in the edge. So in the case of hello, E-L-L-O is not shared with any other key, so therefore it's a single edge that has this. That makes traversing this much, much quicker, and you use less memory to store all this information. So the way you actually implement this, right, you sort of represent it algorithmically through having the key prefixes in the edges themselves, but in practice you actually implement the nodes are actually where you're going to store the data. So in this case here, we have the same keys in our radix tree, and then they just sort of point to the object we're looking for. And so to do an insertion, say we want to insert the word hair, all we need to do is traverse the prefix and find the lowest point where we can add in the remaining portions of our key, and we just insert a new record in there. So what makes radix trees kind of tricky is that you don't want to be allocating new nodes all the time, right? Because it could be that the thing we're trying to insert here had 100 characters afterwards, and therefore wouldn't fit in this node, and we don't want to do a malloc or realloc every single time we're going to do this. So in the hyper system, they actually use different predefined size nodes, and we just have a little extra space when we allocate a node, so that if we come along with a key that is too big or is bigger than we expected, we have room to put it in. Let's say we want to do delete hat and have, so it's these two elements here. Again, we traverse it, we find them, and then we just can delete them. And now we sort of have, just in this node here, we just have I and R by itself, and we can then coalesce it and move everything back up here. I don't know. It's not clear whether you can do this atomically without latches. They're very vague in the paper how to do this, and they say it's future work. But I believe it's possible. You could possibly also use an indirection map or indirection table, like in a BW tree, to make this all work. All right. So So in the paper that I listed on the website, it's not latch free, and they don't actually talk about how much smaller space the prefix tree uses over a B plus tree, which is kind of unfortunate. But it doesn't take much imagination to think about, like, if you have a lot of keys that are strings and they have a lot of overlapping values, this would be much, much smaller than a B plus tree. Again, this is mostly just keep you aware of, like, these are other indexes that are out there and they have some interesting properties. Another tricky thing about the radix tree is that it's trivial for us to see how prefixes work when you have strings. But how do we do this when we have other data types? So there's four types we need to handle, and we have to do a little transformation before we can put it in the tree to make it so that they can be comparable in a fixed order. So for unsigned orders, the key thing we have to be mindful of is if we're on a little endian machine, we have to flip the order of the bits so that the most significant bit is the one we can use to compare whether something's bigger than another, right? Because otherwise it's reversed and it wouldn't work. For signed integers, what you have to do is, if it's negative, you have to flip the 2's complement, because otherwise negative numbers would appear to be larger than positive numbers. So if you just flip that bit, then everything works just as if it was an unsigned integer. For floats, it's a little bit more complicated. It depends on how the machine, I guess there's the IEEE format that determines how you represent a float, but you basically classify a float into different groups, like negative versus positive, normalized versus denormalized, and each of these obviously have their own comparison that can be made. If it's in the negative group, it's less than something within the positive group, and so on. And then that allows you to come up with a well-structured comparison protocol for these floats, and you don't have to do any real transformation of the number itself. For compound keys, it's pretty simple. You just apply all the same techniques and treat them separately. And you can do comparisons sort of as if they were sort of the byte streams were appended together. Like if I had two unsigned integers, I can just compare the first one followed by comparing it with the second one. And everything just works. All right, so again, in a radix tree, there's some little extra work you have to do to make sure that everything's comparable, that you could then have other prefixes and get the better compression rate. This is sort of cool. I'm being sort of very hand-wavy here because I don't think it's something you'd want to implement for project number two, but I think it's a cool idea that you can get lower, you get the lower memory usage without paying that big penalty to go look for every single pointer as you did in the T tree. Okay, so what are my parting thoughts? I think the BW tree is probably one of the most interesting data structures and databases that have come out the last 5, 6, 7 years. I've read the paper, I've seen the experiments, I've talked to people. I'm having trouble thinking about what the problem is, right? Yes, you have to do some extra work to deal with phantoms, but in Hekaton, that's why they just re-scan, they execute the scans and reads again to check for phantoms, right? You don't have to embed anything and do anything heavyweight inside of the index itself to check for phantoms. Whereas in the B plus tree stuff we talked about last time, you can maintain these hierarchical locks inside of it in order to figure things out. It's a bit more complicated to implement, and you have to make sure you get the ordering of the compare and swap operations in the mapping table correctly, right? Because you can end up pointing to nothing. Skiplets, on the other hand, I think are one of the easiest data structures to implement. It's only a couple hundred lines of code. It's really simple to get up and running, and it's not hard to make it concurrent. The standard skiplets that I sort of showed you here can be slow in practice, and there's other more modern variants that are deterministic or use paging mechanisms, sort of like the mapping table in the BW tree, to allow to overcome these challenges. But I just still don't think they're going to perform as well as the BW tree. Okay? All right, so for next class, we're going to read another paper from Microsoft Research. You may be thinking, why do I keep reading Microsoft Research papers? Again, I think their database group is doing some really awesome stuff, right? When you look at the people that they have there, there's some of people that have been in databases for a long time and invent a lot of the stuff that we're learning about, right? Because at Microsoft, the Microsoft Research eventually picked up all these guys that fled all the other research labs that went under, right? When Paul Larson was a professor at Waterloo, but Dave LeMay was at DEC when that folded when Compaq bought him. They had Jim Gray, the Turing Award winner. Now they have Donald Kosman, although he's from Europe, from ETH. But they have some really awesome people, and I think they're doing stuff. And I find their papers are actually really easy to read, right? If you try to go read, you've read the BW tree paper, try go reading the radix tree paper from the Hyper guys, it's not the same. So that's why I think there's a lot of, they're easy to read and they explain things very clearly. All right, so then next class we'll spend probably the last 15, 20 minutes, we'll talk about the last project and we'll talk about what's expected, and then you have a month to do it. Okay? Any questions? All right, guys, see you next time.